Hello, I'm Jack from Shure.
I'm Andy from Yamaha.
And today we are looking at console integration. So tying our Shure radio microphone receivers with our Yamaha consoles.
That's right. We're standing right behind the RIVAGE PM5, the mid-size one in our RIVAGE PM range. And behind us, we have the DM7 in EX configuration with the extra sidecar on the side. But yeah, all the devices in the DM7 and the RIVAGE PM range will do some control with the Shure wireless mic systems.
Excellent. So as we film this video today, we've got the PM5 here. What Shure devices can talk to the PM5?
Yeah, so we have the AD4Q that we can see there, and the ULXD series. Also, the QLXD series can be controlled, and the older Accent AXT400 series. So you have the brand new SLXD series here as well. That will be coming in a later firmware version for the RIVAGE PM series, but it is included in the DM7 series. The latest firmware has been upgraded to allow control of the SLXD, the ULXD, the QLXD series, and the Accent series.
Excellent. Yeah. Where did all this start? Like, when did we start working on this?
Yeah, I believe it was in the year 2013. Mm-hmm. So Yamaha had recently released the CL series of digital mixers, and they have Dante natively built into them. And Shure had released the ULXD series that had Dante built into them. So both devices have Dante, both devices have networked control. Both devices get used in a whole wide range of live sound and entertainment applications. We have a lot of shared customers, don't we? So there's a lot of talk about, well, they're already kind of compatible. What can we do to make them communicate with each other? So Shure's and Yamaha's technical teams got together, discussed and shared protocols, and came up with a plan that worked very well and keeps on working.
Excellent. And what does it give us when we talk about tying these products together? Yeah, what operationally does that mean for our user? What do they get to enjoy?
Yeah, so, well, the key things are our battery status and RF level, aren't they? And then we have RF quality in some of the devices, and we also have receiver gain control, and we can see the actual frequency, and we have a mute status indicator as well. So we have a little bit of control from the mixers and a lot of monitoring, which is particularly handy, isn't it? When you think of a typical venue, you don't always want or can't always have your wireless device receivers in the same place as your mixing desk. You know, you want your mixer probably near the back of the hall, but you want your wireless receivers by the side of the stage, for example, and you don't want to keep on walking between them to check things or to adjust things. So if you can bring the control back to where you're going to be spending most of the time in the performance, then having the control right at the mixing desk makes a huge amount of sense.
Absolutely. So yeah, if I'm on a gig as an RF engineer, I'm hanging out with the rack, and I've got wireless workbench, as we can see here, so I can monitor all that telemetry locally and react to things if there's problems and assist the sound engineer. But yeah, as you say, if you're a lone ranger on a gig in a venue, you're doing front of house monitors, RF, stage patch, having all of that telemetry and the control of the receiver gain at your console has benefits to solve problems and see what's going on. But also, I guess, from a gain structure perspective, right? Because the control here controls the receiver gain on this side directly, doesn't it?
Exactly. Yes. Yeah, you get the RF level, which you can adjust from the console, and that is the signal level that's coming in to the mixing desk at the top of the channel.
So from a game structure perspective, if we didn't have this, I'd have to set a control here, come back to my Yamaha, and then see what it was like and try and get it into a acceptable window. Yeah. But here I can just directly control it at the top of the chain.
Makes life easier, eh? Yeah.
Okay, so what do we need to make this work? We've obviously talked about the specific devices, but in terms of the network topology, what stuff needs to be present to get it right?
Good question. Well, let's begin, as we always should, with check your firmware version on all the devices to make sure they're compatible. So use the latest firmware. And then the next most important thing is check your word clock setting, your sample rate. So everything needs to be working at the same sample rate to share audio. Otherwise, you'll get a huge amount of silence. So sample rate, firmware version, and then we've got to talk about networking. Mm-hmm. So probably we're going to be using Dante networking for the communication. So if your device has a Dante connection, make sure they're all in the same network and using compatible IP addresses. But we also are using a control network. In most cases, that's going to be the same as the Dante network. But some Shure devices don't have Dante. They only have a control network port. So that needs to be brought into the Dante network. Mm-hmm. And everything needs to be running on a compatible set of IP addresses for the control to take place. After that, it's just a case of following a couple of setup menus and we're good to go.
It's worth mentioning at this point that the Shure devices we brought along with us today are the Dante versions, which means that they have two network cards in them. They have two IP addresses, one for the Shure control and one for the Dante. Now, this allows you to set these systems up in different ways. We can have Shure control going off to its own switch. We can have primary Dante and redundant Dante going to separate switches as well. And if that's your workflow for these consoles, they want to see the primary Dante and the Shure control come together into the same network at some point.
Yeah, yeah, it makes it a whole lot easier to use the devices in switched configuration. So one port with both audio and control.
Yeah.
And that's actually how the Yamaha devices have to work.
Okay.
Control of Dante devices comes through the same physical port as the Dante audio, though there are two IP addresses to take care of. It's one physical port. Mm. So having the control and the audio combined is important.
So that's what we've done today. All of these devices are in their switched mode. So primary Dante and Shure control are just coming out of all the hardware LAN ports on the back of the unit. Disadvantage with that is we lose the redundant Dante. So that's worth considering if that's part of your topology. But it is the easiest way to get these systems set up. And continuing the theme of easy mode, we're just in a 169 link local IP address. So
we are, yeah.
Everything just gets its own IP address based on its MAC address, right?
Yeah, yeah. We could type static IP addresses for everything, but hey, that takes too long.
Yep, absolutely. Cool. Okay, let's get into the next video where we show you how to combine the Axiom Digital with the PM5 console. And there'll be another video where we show you how to get the SLXD quad system running with the DM7.
Yep, looking forward to it.